most beautiful Christmas songs. Oh, my goodness. Wow. Mm. So extraordinary. Mm. Well, this is the last Sunday before Christmas. Does that make you nervous? Are you ready? You know, I know some of you are very organized, like Pastor Phil. He'll have Christmas wrapped up 6 months before Christmas. And you know me, I'll be out there Christmas Eve trying to do what needs to be done. Which one of you? I'm curious. You're one or the other, right? And you know, the one could never understand the other, right? Like my brother could never understand me. It's so irresponsible. How could you not be ready? And you know, I have, you know, something to say back to him, of course, but it is the last Sunday before Christmas. And, you know, even with that, let's consider this to be one of our Christmas services. Of course, we have our candlelight service Friday night. Wow, Friday night. But as I look around, I want to welcome you all. And if this is your Christmas service, may God bless you. Amen. May God bless you, Frank and Susan. Wow, Frankie, it's been a long time. Are we allowed to call you Frankie, or is it Frank now? Wow, you look great. You look strong and handsome. All right, yeah, very good. The Hearts, oh my goodness. Yeah, amen, yeah. Brother Jim, we're blessed to have you in the house. Good morning, sir. Thank you for being here. We're blessed. Sister Diana, we love you. Yeah, we're glad you're here. Praise the Lord. You know, did you look in your bulletins? The title of our conversation today is real simple, everybody. It's Christmas, right? It is Christmas. Just take note of the spelling of the word, right? It is absolutely the first word, and that is Christ, right? It is Christ Mass. It's interesting because really Christmas is a holiday that's pretty much celebrated throughout the entire world. Isn't that something? Throughout the entire world. Only God can make something like that happen, you know? Christmas is a time, I don't care if we get lost in presents and I don't know, other things involved with Christmas, but by the very name of the holiday, you cannot deny it is the celebration, commemoration when Christ was born upon the earth. Amen? Now, I always find these things tremendous, that God could etch something like that in history, where whether you call upon his name or not, whether you believe in him or not, isn't that beautiful? It makes no difference. Whether you believe in him or not, he is still your God and he is still your Father. Whether you believe him to be creator or not, he is still your creator. Whether you believe that Christ came to the earth or not, he still came to the earth. And chances are pretty good that you're going to celebrate his birth. Like only God could do that. Oh, it's amazing. Among other things that I see in history that we acknowledge, it's an acknowledgement of God. And you know what I also take note of, the name of the holiday, Christmas. You know, Christ is not the name of our Savior. Even the one born in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago, the angel Gabriel said to Mary, "You shall call his name Jesus." Have you read the Christmas story? Anybody? Do we got it? Luke, everybody, Luke chapter 2. Reverend, you'll lead us. Give us that Christmas story. You shall call, amen. You shall call his name. Okay, all right. I don't know if you guys are there or not. Were you waiting for Christmas? You shall call his name Jesus, because he shall save his people from their sins. Amen. He shall be the savior of the world. And it's fascinating that the name of the holiday is not called Jesus Mess. It's not Jesus Mess. You can if you want, but it is Christmas. Why? There's something significant there, I believe. And even in the name Christ, you know by now, Christ was not the last name of Jesus. Christ was one of his titles. Christ, by definition, is the anointed one. Amen? And Christ is the one that the Hebrew nation waited they waited for a deliverer, a savior that would be born upon the earth that would save them. You know, Israel, they had a real hard time growing up in the world, and at times they were winners and times they were losers. It seems like they had God Almighty as their personal God. Isn't that something? Yet so often they were defeated, and isn't it true? They were defeated and downcast, and they cried out to their God for help as if they weren't the greatest nation on earth. Isn't it interesting that we as Christians who call God our God, Jesus Christ our Savior, that sometimes that's still you and I today. We have Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, yet we're still so defeated most of the times. Why is that? You can look at Israel and wonder. You can just look in the mirror and wonder. Isn't it something? But there was a great cry, always a cry. There was a cry for Christ to be born, for a Savior to come and to save us. And I think that's why Christmas is universal, because there's a cry in the heart of every human being for a Savior. You don't need to be Jewish or Hebrew or American or Chinese. You just need to be a human being for there to be a cry in your heart for a Savior. And that's why the whole world celebrates Christmas, because in the heart of every human being is a cry for salvation, for hope, for deliverance, for healing. There's a cry in your heart, isn't there? You would think Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior, we'd be high and mighty, but most of the times we still need a Savior. I still need a Savior, everybody. Oh, my goodness. But I think that's why it's so universal. Whether you say a prayer to Jesus Christ or not, there's still a celebration of Christmas, because Christ is greater than a Jewish man that lived over 2,000 years ago. Christ is a picture, is an image. He is God, a picture of God in the flesh that has come to save who? Yeah, I believe it's the world. I believe the verbiage is he came to save the world. And maybe that's why the world celebrates something called Christmas. Amen. You know, celebrating Christ has been embraced by us all, and I love the commonality that we all have as human beings. And I think God is bringing us to a greater place than just our small religion. You know, we have said many times, if you can consider Christianity to just be one of the religions of the world, you're not really living in the fullness of truth. Because to serve the Almighty God is not just one sect. Like serving God, living in truth is greater than Christianity. We are not just one of the religions of the world. We serve the one true Almighty Creator of the universe. I mean, we're not in competition against anyone else. We're all human beings. We all have a similar heart and a similar desire. We all have the same Father and the same Creator. Now, you can divide us all day long if you want to. You know that. Now, they do that on the news, and we do that in our lives all day long. You want to divide us? Go ahead and divide us. You want to divide us according to color? Go ahead. Go ahead. We do it all day long. You want to divide us according to our race? Go ahead. You want to divide us according to our gender? We see it all day long on the news. How does that work for us? Not very well. You want to divide us according to our financial status? Go ahead. I'm rich, you're poor. You want to divide us according to being American or being a Chinese or being a Russian? Go ahead. Division is something that man does, not something that God does. You see it in the news, and don't you hate it? Don't you despise it? Don't you see its destruction? So why on earth would we, in the name of God, divide us to say that we are the chosen people of God and the rest of you are just going to hell? Just think about it for a minute. There must be something about God that unites us. You ever see tragedy that happens in the world? What happens when tragedy strikes? Even just a nation. A nation comes together, and there are no dividing lines. I know when something would happen in America, something like the Twin Towers, for example, the Americans, and something, there was something greater than our religion, not greater than our God. Can you see the difference? There's nothing greater than our God. There's nothing greater than God Almighty. But would you allow me to be so bold to say there is something greater than your religion? Because God is greater than your religion. Because God will allow you to hate people and disown people and not to embrace. God will allow, not religion will allow you to do that. But God will not. God will not. And sometimes God allows certain things because he needs something to unite us. Something to say we all have a common fate in this world. Sometimes we're weak and sometimes we're strong. Amen. Sometimes we succeed and sometimes we fail. Sometimes we're right and sometimes we're wrong. Sometimes we deal with, I mean, we have the right to be loved, and sometimes we have no right to be loved. We are one.
Amen.
Let us love one another. Where are you going to draw the line? Where does your love end? Who is not allowed in your circle of love? Who was not allowed in the circle of God's love? Praise the Lord, for God so loved. Oh, so we do know the Bible. So our Christianity does pay off. For God so loved. Man, I got to say that more often, man. Because if God loves the world, then, well, why not? Let's just go for it. Let us see God. Let us see Christ. Christmas is a celebration of the birth of Christ. It's the celebration of humanity, of the universe, that celebrates salvation, that celebrates hope. You tell me where that does not lie. It lies in every human heart. Jesus was a savior. We all need a savior. We all need a deliverer. We all need hope. We all need love. I'll tell you something else. You know what else is universal, everybody? We all need forgiveness. We all need forgiveness. Yeah. Only God can do that. Only God is big enough. Well, he's our creator. He kind of knows a little bit more than us. You know, Christmas, it's a celebration of God that has come in the flesh. Christ is God coming in the flesh. Taking on the form of mankind. Amen. I believe there's another title for God in the flesh. I think on Christmas season, we sing songs with this name. The name is Emmanuel. You ever sing a song that involved the name Emmanuel? Uh-huh. The first two words, O come. Anyone want to sing that? O come. Emmanuel. Because Emmanuel means what? Come on. What does it mean? God is with us. It means God is for us. If you can be so bold, maybe someone wants to say God is in us. Right? Emmanuel. Emmanuel. Emmanuel, God is with us. Sometimes I don't believe it. You want to call somebody an unbeliever. Sometimes I'm an unbeliever. I'm lost in my darkness because I don't believe that God is with me because I'm not with me. I don't believe God is for me because I tell you, a lot of times I'm not for me. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? I'm not for me. I'm not with me. I don't believe in me. There's a cry for Emmanuel. There's a cry deep inside of us that wants to believe that God is with us. Because if you don't believe that God is with you, you are lost. You have no hope in this world, in this life. If you don't believe that God is with you and God is for you, you tell me what human being can sustain that kind of a thought. No human being can sustain that. You will live a miserable, hard life. And I tell you what, sometimes we do. Sometimes we do. Even in our religion, not in our God, in our religion. Can I get an honest amen? Somebody who's been involved with religion a long time, but there's still a cry inside you that says, I have not found my Savior though. I still cry out, come, come, Emmanuel. I still say, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. But I thought you had him. It's like you still need him, don't you? Isn't there still a cry that calls for a Savior that says, come save me from my sin? I have religion, but religion don't do it. I've had religion my whole life, since I was a baby. Anyone else? I've been going to church since I was a baby. No, correction. When I was in my mother's womb, I went to church. When I was just a thought in my father's head, I was in the front row. But my religion didn't save me. I went to church all the time. Some of you? My religion don't save me from my sin. Don't save me from my darkness. Don't save me from my fear and my heartache because I still grew up with it. It still attacked me and haunted me. You too? Come on. Amen. It didn't destroy my enemies. I still slept with the enemy. Amen. Amen. Now my religion helped. But my religion was not my savior. I encourage you to go outside of your religion and find a savior. I encourage you to let somebody else who's outside of your religion to have your savior. I encourage you to give that to someone else who doesn't fit inside the box that you say is worthy of it. Because when it comes right down to it, you don't believe you're worthy of it either. But he gives it to us.
Yes.
Yeah. Christmas, it's a celebration of Christ.
Yes.
That Christ was born. Hope was born. Forgiveness was born. Truth was born. Life was born. Victory was born. Strength was born. It's the cry of every human heart. It's greater than a gift with a holiday with a Christmas tree and with gifts exchanged and drinking hot cocoa and singing the Christmas carols. Enjoy every little bit of it, everybody, but that ain't it. It's a cry in the heart of humanity that says, save me.
Yes.
Every human heart says, save me, Lord.
Yes.
Every human heart says, rescue me. That's Christ.
Yes.
Christ is God come in the flesh to rescue you.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Let us celebrate that.
Yes, sir.
Let us celebrate that. Amen.
Amen.
Let me read a passage here. 1 Peter 1, it says something like this. I don't know, maybe verses 23, 24. 1 Peter says this. It says, you have been born again. You see, Christ is not only born in the earth. Christ, we read in our religion that he's also born in our hearts. Does anybody believe that Christ has been born in their hearts?
Yeah.
You might use a phrase like born again. You can, you don't have to, but you might use a phrase like born again. Born again means Christ has been born again. Where? In a manger? In Jerusalem? Yes. No. In Bethlehem? No. He's been born again where? In my heart.
Yes, sir.
So therefore, Christmas is more than an event that happened in Israel so many years ago. It's greater than that. I know that was a picture of something great, but it was greater than that. Don't you believe your God is greater than you could possibly imagine? He has to be, otherwise he's not God. If you can figure him all out and understand him, explain him, put him in a box, he ain't God. I don't know what you're pointing, but it ain't God. Yeah. If you got him all figured out, know what he likes, what he doesn't like, know who he loves and who he doesn't love, well, I don't know who you're serving, but it ain't God. Something you made. God bigger than you. Bigger than me. Yeah, so Christ... Man, yes, he was born. Yes, he was born in a manger. Yes, he was born in a manger. Yes, he was born of the Virgin Mary. There's no denying that in our Christian religion. There's no denying that. But there's something greater than that. He's still born in the hearts of humankind. To be born again means Christ is born again. Where? Where? In your heart. Christ is born again. Where? In your heart. So therefore, when you celebrate Christmas, you must also celebrate the Christ that is born where?
In your heart.
Oh. I don't do that. I mean, on Christmas Day, I'll hand out presents and do the Christmas thing, but I don't always celebrate the real Christmas, which was Christ that was born in my heart.
Yes.
Christmas, I celebrate the birth of Christ. Where? In a manger? Okay. But isn't there something greater than that? How about the Christ that's born in your heart? How come we haven't come to the place yet? I haven't. Well, I don't really celebrate the Christ that's born in me. You know why I can't celebrate the Christ that's born in me all the time? Because I'm not happy with me. Can I speak for you? Am I speaking for you? I could say I'm not satisfied, but that don't cut it. I'm not happy with me. Forget about satisfied. Like every now and again, I get a glimpse like I'm King Kong, but it's very rare. Oh, wow, man, you're laughing way too hard at that. That was an inappropriate place to laugh. Like, every now and again, you have delusions of grandeur. But I say as a human race, Most of the times, we're not pleased with ourselves. And we're not pleased with each other. And very rarely do we celebrate Christmas. The Christ that is born where?
In our hearts.
Come on, that's Sunday school stuff. How come we don't know this? Christ is born in our hearts. How come I don't celebrate the Christ that's born in my heart? Because I think there's something bigger than the Christ that's born in my heart. I think I'm bigger than the Christ that's born. I think my failure is bigger. I think my my weakness is bigger. Do you? Do you? Well, you're not normal if you didn't agree with me. Just saying. Christ is so big. Sometimes we wonder as Christians why the world doesn't see that and the world doesn't embrace that. But then we also must bring it to a real realm and say, how come I can't celebrate the Christ in me? Why am I more focused up on my sin and my failure and my weakness and my sickness?
All the time.
Well, oh, okay, Reverend. Why am I not celebrating Christmas,
yes,
the birth of Christ? Because Christ, it says here in 1 Peter, it says, for you have been born again. Don't be afraid. For you have been, everybody?
Born again.
Born again. Not of corruptible seed, just like the original. Not of, just like the original. He wasn't born of a man. He was born of a virgin.
Yes.
Just like you. You're not born of corruptible seed. You've been born again of incorruptible seed.
Amen.
Who? Every one of you.
Yes.
Every one of you. Scripture says, you were born through the word of God, which lives and abides forever.
Uh-huh.
You are more extraordinary than you give yourself credit for.
Yes.
Well, you don't get credit, but you can experience it. Because all flesh is grass. Now, we can all, sometimes we grab onto this real good and real easy. I got no problem with this one, everybody. I got no problem. All flesh is grass. And all the glory of man is as the flower of grass. And what does Scripture tell us? I know this is true. The grass withers. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Oh, that's our human life sometimes. What does the grass do? It withers, man. What about all the glories? And the flower? Falls away.
Yes.
But is there a but? I don't know, a but or something. Oh, there's a but. You know what they say in English class, but you erase everything that was written prior, right? Hallelujah! There's a but there. But the word of the Lord endures forever. And that's what we're born. We're born of the word, incorruptible. We are born of the word. You know, okay, let's read this. So now this is the word by which the gospel was preached to you. This is the word that you were born of, incorruptible seed. I know, you know what we get stuck in? I know, according to our human minds, we get stuck in, we are the grass that withers and the flower that fades.
Yes.
For all flesh is as the grass of the field. And the glories of life, you ever had the glories of life? Have you had some real highs in life? Anybody had some real highs in life? Well, you thought that you were rich and famous and Gary, yeah. I've noticed that. Very proud man over there. Have you ever been rich and famous? Some of you not there yet. Some of you never been there. In my mind, in my dreams, I've been rich and famous. And I don't know, have you been strong? Have you been young? Yeah, you ain't young no more. Yeah, you ain't young and strong no more. You used to have a mind sharp as a tack, and now you got a real good memory. It's just not very long. Yeah, for all of the glories of flesh, they shall fall. And we get stuck in that. I'm just but grass that withers. And I always forget the but. But that's not all who that we are. But the word of the Lord endures forever. But you are born of incorruptible seed, which will not wither and will not fade. there is a Christ in you that needs to be celebrated. Can I get a witness? Now, I know we're going to leave here today, and I know most of us are going to do the Christmas thing. You're going to have dinner? Any of you cooking? Anybody eating? Well, there better be somebody cooking then. I mean, all you cooks, you better get on it. I know you're going to cook. I know you're going to eat more than God knows you should eat. But there'd be a smile on your face. On and on. But God does not want you to deny Christ. Don't deny the Christ. How can you celebrate Christmas and deny the Christ?
Yes, sir.
There's a Christ born in you.
Yes.
Can you celebrate the Christ in you?
Yes.
Or just the withering, falling flower grass of you? Is that all that you acknowledge in your life, is the withering, fading part of you? Will you celebrate Christmas with me this year?
Yes.
Will you celebrate the Christ that is in you? That is indestructible and incorruptible? Will you celebrate something about you that is absolutely beautiful, beyond the beauty of this world? Will you celebrate something inside of you that is so divine, that is so strong? Will you celebrate the Christ in you?
Yes.
Or will you deny him?
Yes.
Or will you deny him? We think the right thing to do is to deny the Christ in us. It's humble. It's not humble. It's wrong. Will you acknowledge the Christ in you?
Yes.
Christ was born in you. Won't you celebrate that? You know, in the Bible, there's types of Christ. You know, all of, and if, you know, those of us involved in our Christian religion, and I was raised in it, and I'm very proud of it, I must say, there are types of Christ in the Bible. Has anyone ever heard that there are types of Christ in the Old Testament?
Amen.
Like David was a type of Christ. Noah was a type of Christ. Why were they types of Christ? Because they were saviors. They were types of Christ. You know, in the Old Testament, the firstborn was a type of Christ. Do you remember when Israel was in Egypt and they had to take the blood of the lamb and put it upon the lentils, and the angel of death passed over?
Yes.
And those who had the blood on their,
yes,
their doors were saved?
Yes.
Because it represented the death of the firstborn. It represented Christ. You know, the firstborn is a type of the Christ. And to know that, if Christ is in you, then it's a representation of the firstborn. Sometimes we see ourselves as human beings primarily, and after we live this human life for a while, we invite Christ into our life, but that's not true. Because before you were human, you were invisible. Before you were human, you were spirit.
Yes.
You were in the Father, you were spirit. You were spirit before you were flesh and blood. And therefore, the true part of you is the Christ part of you, not the natural part of you. The firstborn, who you really are, I'm going to tell you who you really are. You ready, Brother Mark? I know you are. I'll tell you all day long who you really are. I'll tell you all day long who you really are. You are the strong one. You are the Christ one, the God one. You were born of God, created from the divine. Undeniable. I know that he put you upon this earth and he wrapped